In 1964, Nikolai Kardashev reasoned that the most fundamental way to classify how advanced a civilization was based on its energy consumption. The more energy they consume, which means control, then the more sophisticated the civilization must be. Kardashev even proposed a scale for quantifying how advanced civilizations are. He called a civilization type 1 if it was able to harness all of the energy striking its planet from the parent star, which for the Earth is about 1.7 times 10 to the 17 watts. Such a civilization should have complete control of their planetary environment, weather, and resources, as well as their local orbit. Going further, a type 2 civilization would have a power consumption comparable to the output of a star, which for the Sun is 3.8 times 10 to the 26 watts. Such civilization would be using stars as engines, effectively, harnessing them using constructions such as Dyson spheres, perhaps. Finally, a Type 3 civilization would have a power consumption comparable to a galaxy. That's something like 5 times 10 to the 36 watts. Such a civilization would be so advanced, it's very difficult for us to make any kind of predictions about what they would be like, and thus, there's probably not too much point worrying about type 4 or 5 or 6 beyond that either. Now you might wonder, where does humanity fall on this scale? Well, it was Carl Sagan who extended Kardashev's idea to a continuous scale by noting that the energy levels are logarithmically uniformly distributed, and thus one can fit a straight line through the log of these three power levels. So I'm showing you the three energy levels here. Let's repeat Sagan's calculation and fit the three power levels assuming a log linear law. This gives us the following equation for our Kardashev level K, where P is the power used by your civilization in watts. Now last year in 2017, humanity's average power consumption was 17.9 terawatts. That would give us a Kardashev score of 0.60. Yet you might say that 0.6 isn't too far off 1.0, but remember this scale is logarithmic. So in order to go from 0.6 to 1, we have to increase our power consumption by a factor of 1 million. Now there are those out there who would say no problem. Humanity's growth is itself exponential, and thus we should achieve type 1 status in a matter of centuries.
But if you get a calculator, you can calculate when we will attain type 1 status. The answer is in about 100 years.
But does this check out? Okay, so here's the average power consumption of humanity over time. And at first glance, you know, such a claim seems reasonable. It does look exponential. If we take the logarithm of the power axis there, then the growth certainly looks exponential, even in log space up to the mid 20th century. And that's something we call hyper-exponential growth. But in more recent decades, that hyper-exponential growth behavior has shut off, and so clearly extrapolating this data into the far future is going to be sensitive to what model you assume. Okay, so let me show you four models that I fitted to this data set. First, the most common is the exponential and a hyper-exponential in red and orange respectively. Then, a logistic and a hyper-logistic model are coming in green and blue. A logistic function looks like a leaning S, and it mimics the growth of biological populations, which tend to explode and then saturate at some maximum capacity level. Now, as you can see, all four of these models do a pretty good job of explaining the current data, but if we go forward in time, they give very different predictions about the future. The exponential model sees us becoming a type 1 civilization by about 4100 AD. Whereas the hyper-exponential is far sooner in the mid-2300s. Now, whilst those numbers seem promising, both of the logistic functions predict we'll actually stabilize our energy consumption way before becoming a type 1, predicting a maximum Kardashev score for humanity of something like 0.65. Now, the real point here is to show you that you can come up with a wide variety of seemingly plausible models to explain the current energy trends we've seen over the last couple of centuries. But extrapolating those models into the far future leads to wildly different predictions. But for the sake of this video, let's be optimistic. Let's assume that we do not saturate at some capped energy level, but we keep on growing up to type 1 status. So what would that even look like? How would we increase our energy by a factor of a million? Today, humanity gets its energy consumption from a variety of sources, such as fossil fuels, geothermal, nuclear fission, wind, waves, tides, and solar. First off, fossil fuels are really not a contender as a pathway to becoming a Type 1 civilization, because even at current levels of usage, we're likely to dry up our oil reserves in about a century, let alone if we increased our energy demand by a factor of a million. It's really not a candidate. And that's not to say anything about the stupidity of turning your home planet into a giant greenhouse. But what about using the Earth itself? Let's take wind and wave power. Well, the first thing to note there is that wave power is largely driven by the wind, so you can't really double dip on both. There is some debate about exactly how much energy is contained within the Earth's winds, but we do know, of course, that winds are ultimately generated by the sun's energy warming up the atmosphere. So a starting point is to note that the Earth's surface absorbs about 9 times 10 to the 16 watts of solar radiation. Now that power warms the entire Earth, but wind power is generated by the residuals, the thermal differences between regions. In 2004, Vaclav Smil estimated that at best about 2% of this incident energy ultimately gets transferred to the air in the form of kinetic energy. And so wind power has to be less than this number. So put together, wind power and by proxy wave power would have a maximum theoretical power level of about 1800 terawatts. And that's assuming 100% efficient energy extraction. Now what about tidal energy though? Tidal energy is different. It is generated not by solar radiation, but by the gravitational influence of the moon and the sun. The total amount of power dissipated through tides by the Earth's oceans is now well determined, with techniques such as altimetry, satellite and lunar laser ranging all agreeing on a value of 3.7 terawatts. And it's a similar story for geothermal energy, which is ultimately driven by the internal heat of the Earth itself. That gives you about 47 terawatts. Again, not at the right level for what we need. Now this just leaves us with two contenders left in the game, solar energy and nuclear energy. Present-day nuclear power plants use fission to generate their energy. That's the splitting of heavy atomic elements. But it has long been a dream that we could exploit the nuclear fusion process in the future. That's the combination of lighter atomic elements together. Now, it's a long-running joke that nuclear fusion power plants are always 40 years away from us. It never seems to get any closer. But let's just make the assumption we'll figure this out one day, and we will have nuclear fusion power. Now, nuclear fusion can happen with the combination of really any two elements you want. But the most energy-efficient process identified for nuclear fusion power plants is the combination of deuterium and tritium. Now, these two are heavy isotopes of hydrogen, which is a fancy way of saying they just have extra neutrons in their atomic nucleus than a hydrogen atom does. Now, fortunately, there's no shortage of deuterium here on the Earth. There's something like 40 trillion tons of the stuff just in our oceans. Tritium, however, is far rarer. It's only found in trace amounts inside water. So typically, it is produced by the reaction of free neutrons and lithium inside nuclear reactors. Now that sounds great, but lithium is also a fairly rare commodity too. There's only about 30 million tons of the stuff in the ground, in the reserves that we have, but there's probably an extra 200 billion tons of the stuff dissolved in seawater. So if we had access to all of that lithium that's dissolved, we'll be able to make something like 90 billion tons of lithium. Now, since each deuterium-tritium fusion reaction creates 17.59 mega electron volts of energy, we would expect the total amount of energy that we could extract from nuclear fusion would be something like 5 times 10 to the 28 joules. That would be enough to power a Type 1 civilization's energy needs for approximately 10,000 years. So nuclear fusion could be a viable pathway to becoming a Type 1 civilization, but what about solar? Well, of course, solar energy is generated from the sun, and it's important to remember that the sun is, in essence, a giant nuclear fusion power plant in the sky. Now, on the Earth, one of the big problems with nuclear fusion is confinement. How do you keep this hot plasma together at extreme enough pressures and temperatures in order to kickstart the nuclear fusion process. But on the sun, confinement happens for free. It happens from the own self-gravity of the star itself. Yet more, space is very empty, and thus the transmission of energy from the sun to the top of the Earth's atmosphere is essentially lossless. Finally, there is clearly enough power to become a Type 1 civilization from solar, because that's actually how we define a Type 1 civilization. It's one which uses all of the solar radiation incident upon its planet. So, all you need to do is tile your planet with solar cells and hey, you're a Type 1. Now you might say, wait, where would I live? Well, this doesn't mean there's no living space, it just means all of the living space is underneath the solar panels. However, even this extreme scenario is probably not enough, because solar cells are not 100% efficient. Modern solar technology is something like 25% efficient, and there are some laboratory demonstrations which approach 50% efficiency. But a 100% efficient solar cell is impossible. And that's because the maximum theoretical efficiency of such a device is governed by the ratio of the temperature of the receiver to the temperature of the emitter. In our case, that's the Earth to the Sun. The so-called Carnot efficiency of this system would be, at best, 95%. We could never do better than that. And you might say, no worries, I'll just build a giant solar cell farm in space and beam the energy back to the Earth. But even that has some problems. The conservation of energy now becomes your enemy. Energy cannot be destroyed or created. It can only be transformed from one form to another. And that's not some Jedi doctrine. That's the first law of thermodynamics. If a civilization uses a certain amount of energy to power their civilization, that energy doesn't just disappear after they're done with it. It becomes waste heat. It warms their planet. And that statement is true no matter what your energy source is, be it solar, nuclear, or antimatter. Right now, the waste heat generated by humanity's activities is so minuscule, it really doesn't make any difference to the temperature of the planet. But for a Type 1 civilization, it's a different kettle of fish. One way to calculate this is to take the solar energy scenario, and I'm going to walk you through a very simple calculation for the equilibrium temperature of the Earth. That's a very basic calculation we often give our students in intro level classes here. Using the Stefan-Boltzmann law, one can show that a planet's temperature approximately equals this, where I have labeled here the various terms for you. The albedo term is the key here. That's how much light is reflected back into space without ever being absorbed by the planet. For the Earth, it's about 30%. Now, if you are a Type 1 civilization, you do not want 30% of the solar radiation to be reflected back into space. That's energy that you need to power your civilization with. So by tiling your planet with very efficient solar panels, you essentially make your planet very, very dark, dropping the albedo here down to zero. So hopefully you can see from this equation that if I decrease the albedo, I'm going to raise the temperature. And in fact, it would raise the Earth's temperature by about 24 degrees Celsius or 43 degrees Fahrenheit. And that's really huge. It would render large portions of your planet completely uninhabitable. And you can't really geoengineer your way out of this problem either. For instance, the idea of building a giant space-based mirror, such as in the trailer Clara that we did in the last video, that's not going to work, because then you're reflecting away the very energy that you need to power your civilization. And switching to a different energy source than solar, say nuclear power, is really not going to help you. In fact, it's going to make things even worse, because now not only do you have to dissipate all of the waste heat generated by your nuclear reactors, but you also still have to get rid of all of that energy which your planet is absorbing from the sun anyway. You have twice the problem to deal with. So no matter how you look at it, becoming a Type 1 civilization is going to cause your planet to warm up. So I would claim that a Type 1 civilization maybe has two options for getting around this. Let me know if you have other options you can think of. One would just be to build a giant air conditioner, have everybody live inside and keep those small volumes cool. Okay, another option, which might be a bit more realistic, I think, would be that to relax this assumption that we have to live on a single planet, to let our civilization spread out to the other planets and moons in your solar system. That way you don't have to dissipate all of the energy in a single location, allows you to keep each of those bodies a bit cooler. So hopefully I've convinced you at the end of this video that becoming a Kardashev Type 1 civilization would dramatically change our way of life. It's not going to be business as usual. Now, scientists like myself do these types of thought experiments and calculations because ultimately we're interested in what these civilizations would look like in our telescopes. And the only way you can really figure that out is to sort of put yourself in their shoes and imagine what your planet would be like, which is kind of what we've done in this video. If you're interested in the detection of such civilizations, I'm actually helping to organize a meeting about that topic in Houston later this month. So stay tuned on this channel for more videos after that meeting where I'll tell you about some of the techno signatures people were getting excited about. Hey, if you've got this far through the video, then you must have enjoyed the content. So please consider subscribing to our channel. I bet this video will generate some pretty interesting comments and questions. So please do put them down below and I will try to get back to you. So until the next video, stay thoughtful, stay curious.